Welcome everybody back. So let me shortly summarize again the main result we just had before lunch. So we arrived at the spin wave theory expression that our Hamiltonian, within spin wave theory, has the ground state energy nz over 2 ss plus 1 plus the coupling constant here is also the J, and then we have the sum over all momenta, the spin wave dispersion relation, B dagger Q, the Bogdanov transformed, bosonic operators, and we have the factor plus 1/2. And E of Q is correctly Z squared minus epsilon Q squared square root times, this factor goes into JS. And yes, if one expands, so epsilon goes to Z for Q going to zero. If we square it, it cancels this term. But so epsilon is Z minus Q squared. If we square it, there are cross terms, so in the end, it actually behaves linear in Q. So, and I was confused if one goes from the antiferromagnetic XY model towards the symmetric Heisenberg point, it's linear, but if one goes into the other directions at the critical point, it becomes quadratic. So towards the phase, to an Ising ferromagnet, it's quadratic. That the phase transitions towards the Ising antiferromagnet, it's linear. That was my confusion in my head. And especially in 1D, it is this famous dispersion relation, square root. Oh, square root drops out. So then we have just cosinus squared here times 2, Z is 2. So then we have 1 minus cosine squared. So that's square root of sinus squared of Q, and so the square root drops out, so it's absolute value. And if one will plot it, it has this nice dome shape. Here is pi minus pi as a function of Q e of k. And so it actually becomes twice zero at the Brion zone boundary, it touches zero again, and there's again a linear dispersion. Good, and importantly also, we now can get by this factor 1/2 a better estimation. So if we now plot our lower bound, our ground state energy, and I divide this by this factor nzj divided by 2, so divided by nzj divided by 2, then we know it must be larger than S times S plus 1. But now we have another bound, so S times S plus 1 with this factor 1/2 here. So it's plus 1/2. Now I take the Z out of the dispersion relations. I have the J S which I take out here. So then I have 1/2 S sum over Q of square root 1 minus epsilon of, epsilon of K divided by J divided by Z squared. And this is squared and squared. And this is a, so if this, I tried to evaluate it, but I wasn't sure whether I probably would have made a mistake, so I don't give you the number for 2D. But if you do it carefully, just insert everything, and you find that you now your ground state energy is better bound by this contribution, which is lower than the energy of the pure nil stage. It actually was S squared. Gut. Questions so far. So this is not a valence bond, it's just if everything will be a spin singlet. Each bond is spin singlet.
So that's a valence
yes,
bond
yes. Okay, and just to be very precise, so you see I divided by the number of particles, so I made the this summation into an integral. So now I actually should write integral dq in a dimension 2 pi over the dimension of the system. Because it took out the number of lattice sites, and with that I get of the discrete summation into an integral.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, certainly.
So is it positive?
No, you're right, this is a minus and okay. Then a plus. thanks. yes. Good. Then let's look, what do we know? So this is an estimation. We know it works at high dimensions and high spins. Let's see whether it's also valid at low dimensions and low spins. What can we do? Which methods? So for spin 1/2, we have quantum Monte Carlo simulations. They are very efficient. There's no frustrations in it. And people have done it in the 80s, 90s to extremely high precision, studied the Heisenberg model on a square lattice in different dimensions. So what are the results for the ground state? First, indeed, one finds always a spin wave, a nail state antiferromagnetic order. So d equals 3, there is a finite critical temperature below which the antiferromagnetic order establishes. So finite critical temperature Tc. But quantum fluctuations reduce the order, so this, if you think how strongly do we point in one direction, this m vector gets reduced by a significant factor, but it's still good long-range order. In 2D, we know that we have Merman-Wagner's theorem, so there can no spontaneous symmetry breaking in 2D appear at finite temperature. So that means the nail order can only establish at zero temperature. So only at zero temperature long range order. Now we are used from Bose-Einstein condensate, where we break also a continuous symmetry in 2D. There we find the Kosterlitz-Faulis transition, so that below a critical temperature, we don't have long-range order, but quasi-long-range order. It decays algebraically. But that was a U1 symmetry. Here we break SU2 symmetry, which means the order parameter has two directions, and therefore it's a different transition. That means there's no quasi-long-range order. It always decays exponentially the correlation length at any finite temperature. But there is a known law how the correlation length behaves. So at finite temperature, we have a correlation length xi as a function of temperature. That means, and it is c has a scaling c xi e of 2 pi rho S divided by temperature. And that means that spin-spin correlation decay always with d distance I minus j divided by the coherence length xi of t. So that means if you have a finite temperature systems and you want to see antiferromagnetic order in two dimensions, your system should be larger than its coherence length here. And this is what has been nicely seen in experiment by Markus Greiner. So you have already seen this picture recently during this week. So let me try to explain it again. So this is really the realized fermionic Hubbard model on a square lattice in two dimensions. They managed via this flattening of the system in the center to dump energy into the reservoirs. So it's very difficult to cool the spins. So it's, here is the phase diagram. Now you immediately see there's something wrong in the phase diagram in 2D, because I just told you that there's actually no antiferromagnetic phase except at zero temperature. So there, this is actually the phase diagram as you expected in three dimensions. But there is an area where we can see antiferromagnetic order over the size of their system sizes, once the coherence length is larger. And it's very hard actually to cool the spin degrees of freedom. And that's one of the major problems to actually, and why it took so long in experiments to see this nice antiferromagnetic ordering. And here's just a snapshot. So first is the demonstration. That's the true image. That's the processed image. So each blue dot means the lattice site is occupied. So they have a good MOT insulator in a sample. Nearly all sites are perfectly filled. And if they remove one spin from the system and then image, they find a nice checkerboard lattice, which means that the remaining spins, which are spin up, form a nice structure like we expect from the nail state. Now, how lucky do they have to be to see this picture? So now if you're PhD students in Markus Greiner's lab and you have to do the experiment, how often do you actually expect this picture to see, even if everything works fine? So even if they have perfect nail order in the system, do they always see such a nice picture? Okay, let's assume the coherence length is larger than the system size. Now we know, yes, the M is reduced. In 2D, actually I wrote it down, so M is 0.6. That means that on average the spin is no longer spin 1/2, so on average it goes to 1/4 of a spin. So yes, due to that factor, they expect it to reduce it. But it's a much more dominant factor that they hardly will ever see this picture. Because you have to imagine it's a symmetry broken phase. They only see this picture if the spins are accidentally polarized along set, spin up, set, spin down, set, spin up. But all the directions where they choose the M are equally valuable. So if they accidentally prepare an antiferromagnetic state pointing in X direction, they don't see anything. Then it's just random measurements. And the magnetization, the stacked magnetization is zero. If they is in X directions, it's also zero. Only if by random choice of the system decides to choose the order along Z direction, then they see this nice picture. Yes?
Can't you force it by having like a very small magnetic field in the Z direction?
You could probably. Now I have to think again, because yes, it's antiferromagnetic order. So a magnetic field doesn't help you because half of the spins are up, half of the spins are down on average. So you would have to make a staggered magnetic field. A magnetic field which is up, down, up, down, up, down on each lattice side. Then you can really pin the face. So in the end, this is actually what they measure, the histogram. So this is, take this sample here and calculate the magnetization, the stacker magnetization from these pictures they see, and measure the distribution function. So essentially count how many spin ups do we have, how many spins down. So yes, sometimes I see all spins up. Once I remove the spin down, so. Yeah, so they have to decide, does this count as spin up or does this count as spin down? So we have to decide the minus sign as our first order here. So therefore, we can shift this pattern by one lattice side, then we get minus staggered magnetization. And if we shift it back, we get plus. So that's why these graphs are symmetric. And this is the zero line. But you see, most of the time, they don't find any staggered magnetization. And it's fully consistent because the spin just lies accidentally within the xy plane. The picture which I show here is one very far out in its tail here. So important to understand, even if you perfectly do your experiments, sometimes it's good not to see what you expect, because it tells you that you're doing it right. And actually, the curves here, so the red is the experimental data. The solid line are the published the results which were calculated from the Heisenberg model. But in the end, they are doing the Hubbard model. And they don't have such a high U because they still want to see dynamics. They have a finite T and a finite U. So the blue line is actually the calculations based on full counting statistics of the Hubbard model during quantum Monte Carlo of the Hubbard model and not of the Heisenberg model. And therefore, you see the blue line, there are strong deviations from the Heisenberg model for realistic experiments. Good. So this is how it works in 2D. Yes?
Each point, to what it corresponds? I mean, why the each side who is marked as full is not like a neat image?
So.
Is it because of the resolution? Or
so here or?
No, in the image, yes. Why is there points?
So you mean this missing?
No.
Here. So this is the data they process. These are all the scattered photons they measure. And because they have no single side resolution, but very tricky one. So they have to post-process the data, which is, yeah, so here one sees a little bit something like that, but it's really the statistics of the photon scattering. And then they post-process it to deduce where the atoms are sitting. And this is the deduced picture from the pure data. So that's the difference between what you see on your data, on your LCD camera, and after processing it by calibrating the experiment correctly, indicating which signal do we count as a particle on this lattice site, which signal do we count as no particle. Yes, and here this is the histogram, so it tells you just with which probability do you find a staggered magnetization at this point. So that means how often do you have to repeat the experiment that you actually see this magnetization. And here you see nearly perfect magnetization, so they were really far out in the tails here. Yes, yes.
Okay, so that's quantum fluctuations?
Yes.
And when you say in 2D it's below 1, it starts
It's a little bit. No, no, 1 is the perfect nail state.
So it goes like from 0 at the transition as a function of temperature?
Exactly, if it goes from 0.
But it doesn't reach 1.
It doesn't reach 1. It's below.
But
it's always below 1. Higher than 0.6. I don't know. I would have to look it up in literature what it is. Yes. Good, what happens in 1D? Everything also perfect, you will find a perfect antiferromagnetic phase. And 1D is very nice because it's exactly solvable. So you can use Bethe-Ansatz, map the system to fermions, use this theory, Bethe-Ansatz theory. It's an exactly solvable quantum many-body system. And in principle, you know all the properties. In practice, it's very hard to derive them and get results out. But in 1D, it's also an antiphagocytic state, exactly at zero temperature. At finite temperature, then order is destroyed. So also in 1D, antiphagocytic. At t equals zero. Good, so we can say all these problems with these valence bond states, that maybe the states just form singlets, is not so important. Whenever we have a Heisenberg model, it just chooses its antiferromagnetic state until 1980. Because then suddenly somebody noticed something in 1D. If you don't take spin 1/2, but actually increase the spin to spin 1, life is completely different. So let us look what happens in 1D for spin d equal 1. Now I can remove that. So, Heisenberg model in dimension 1, but now with spin s equal 1. So naively we would have said we know that for large spin, the nail state gets better and better. So you would have naively expect, if you go from s 1/2 to s equal 1, the nail state should just become stronger. So let me write down again the Hamiltonian. So now it's just, I can order it by lattice side, si plus 1. And I will add later something behind here, immediately. But what one finds, you can either by numerics, or originally by theoretical analysis by Duncan Haldane, that it actually should be a gap state. So, unique ground state. It has an excitation gap. No long range order at all, no spin order. Yeah, no order. And most remarkably, if you have a finite system, the ground state is degenerate, and the degeneracy is due to edge states at the end of the chain. So, open system. Fourfold degenerate. And edge states. And that was really remarkable. We didn't do a lot. Normally you would just say classically, spin just likes to order. So what is so fundamentally different in one dimension, and where does it go wrong? And that's a very nice model where one can derive the ground state analytically. So let me add a term to this Hamiltonian. So let me write plus lambda over 3, and let us just take this term again and square it. So that's si times si plus 1, and the full expression squared. So for lambda equals 0, we have the Heisenberg model. For lambda equal 1, this has acquired the name of AKLT. And the names are Affleck, Lieb, Kennedy, and Tasaki. Good, and the beauty is, I will demonstrate to you that we can write down a ground state by hand immediately to this model if we set lambda equal 1. And you will understand exactly all these properties appearing from this ground state wave function. So let us start and notice what does this term actually do. So let's look again at our system. So we have now a spin 1 on each lattice side. So that means each bond has now three different spin values which we can have. So each bond can be a singlet, a triplet, or have a spin s equal 2. Because we have spin 1, the spin addition theorem tells us that each bond can now have these three possibilities. So let's calculate the energy for one bond for the different total spin on each bond. So, energy of a single bond. Now let us make a table. So here we have the total spin. Which can be 0, 1, and 2. Then we evaluate the SI dagger SI plus 1. And to evaluate that, we use again our trick. So this is 1/2 SI plus SI plus 1. Squared, so this is the total spin squared, minus Si squared as j plus 1, so that's minus Si squared minus Si plus 1 squared. Now we have spin 1, so that means this factor is, for spin 1 it's 1 times 2, it should be 4. Yes. So that means this factor is always minus 4 for spin 1. For spin 1/2, this factor was minus 3 over 2. Because now S is a spin 1 particle, we get that S squared is L S times S plus 1, which is 2. And then we have the last row, which is the energy. Good, so let's evaluate that. So for spin equals 0, this is 0, this is minus 2. So now we go to the Hamiltonian. We have minus 2, minus 2 squared is 4 divided by 3. So we have 4 divided by 3 minus 2. So the total energy is 4 divided by 3 minus 2. And that's, let's hope I didn't make any stupid mistakes, that's 6, that's minus 2 over 3. Then we go to total spin S equal 1. So questions or did I make a mistake? Hopefully not. So we go total spin S equal 1. So this is S total S times S plus 1. So that's 2 minus 4 is also, no, 2 minus 4 is minus 2 divided by 2 gives minus 1. So then we have minus 1. Let's calculate the energy. So we have minus 1, 1 squared. So that's minus 1 plus 1/3. So that's minus 1 plus 1/3. That's also equal to minus 2 over 3. Yes?
Are we working at lambda equal 1?
Yes. AKLT, lambda equal 1. Yes. And the last one, if you have spin equal 2, so 2 times 3 is 6, minus 4 is 2, divided by 2, this is plus 1, and then we have 1 plus 1 third, so that's 4 over 3. So, while for the Heisenberg, yes? Okay, let's try it again. So I have here total spin 1. So the squared is s times s plus 1. So this is 2. Minus 4 is minus 2 divided by 2. Always keep in mind that we have to use the spin formula, l times l plus 1, for the total spin squared. Good. So while for the Heisenberg model, we argued that this term projects onto singlets alone. If we add this term with lambda equal 1, then the singlet and the triplet have the same energy. It just forbids the S equal total spin S equal 2. And so the natural question is, can we satisfy this constraint? Can we write down a wave function which on each link is either total spin s equal a singlet, s equal 1, s equal 0, or s equal 1? And the answer is, indeed, one can achieve such a state. And especially you see the nail state, which is spin up, spin down, spin up, spin down, has always an overlap with s equal 2. If you think then the perfect nail state has on the first side, so it's spin up, spin down. That means it's the state 1, 1, tensor 1, minus 1. Now look at all the Clebsch-Gordan table for the spin addition. You will find that this term has total magnetization m equals 0, but that happens in all, in a singlet, in a triplet, and in a s equal 2. So if we calculate the overlap with spin equal 2, it has a finite overlap. And therefore, the nail state is not such a state which just lives here. It has contribution from this part. And any antiferromagnetic state will have contribution from this part. So if we find a state which just has total spin 0 and total spin 1 on each bond, we have found the ground state. So let's construct such a state. For Heisenberg, we have just, it's close by, and So it's still an argumentation that one has to prove that the state which I show you adiabatically connects to the Heisenberg state. But that we know nowadays. So I cannot prove that the Heisenberg state has also these properties. I construct your wave function with exactly the same properties, and then you can do numerics and find if you adiabatically turn lambda off and go to the Heisenberg point, everything remains the same. Let me especially do it because the construction of the wave function is really fun. So, because we make a trick, we know that the spin 1 we can write as the sum of 2 spin 1 halves, and then a projection onto the triplet state. So, let's write each lattice site instead of a spin 1 as 2 spin 1 half states. So we have our chain, these are our lattice sites. These are originally spin one particles, but now we are theoretical physicists. We split our spin one into two particles, into two spin one half. So we have a right here, a right here, right here, and blue, 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 and also here, and here. So, introduce two spin one half. I call them Fi one, Fi two on each lattice site. Now we have a too large Hilbert space, because our lattice site in spin one has three states. If we write it as spin 2 1/2, we get four states, so we have also the singlet. So therefore, whatever we construct, we have to make a projection onto the triplet state. So we introduce in addition a projection P, which is the product over all lattice sites, the projection onto spin one. And this brings our too large Hilbert space back to our physical Hilbert space. And you remember how we can write this, because that's the Heisenberg term for the Hubbard model, so that we can write as 3 over 4 plus F I 1 times F I 2. Good, so what we did is we enlarged our Hilbert space. Now we can write it as spin 1/2. And we know all physical states we obtain by projecting onto the spin 1 state. Some states will vanish, but whenever we make a trial wave function and this projection does not vanish, we find a valid wave function. Good. Now what do we do with our spin 1/2? We just make singlets out of them. We are not allowed to make within singlets, but now we can make singlets between the sites. So therefore, let's write the wave function where we now have the blue gets a singlet with the red one. And this blue gets a singlet with this red one. So is there another color? So now we make singlets. And also this. Also this. So that means we write our wave function, our trial wave function, as psi is equal the product over all lattice sites. And we have a blue spin here, and then at site I, then we have the red spin 1/2 at site I plus 1, and then the reversed blue spin up at site I, and the red spin down I plus 1, and a minus sign and the bracket closed. So now you write a wave function. This is now a wave function in a basis state of our spin 1/2. And we just make a product of singlets. But the singlets are between the sites. And if you want to get the physical wave function, we now apply the projection with P. So our true wave function is now our projection onto psi. Now let's shortly think. The claim is this wave function doesn't have any spin 2 component on each bond. Does somebody see immediately why? So let's just write a bond down. So a bond here in this language is now four spins. So a valid state is up, up, down, down. So let's make the colors. So up, down, up, up. But you see, we always have a singlet quenched in between. So if you write down this wave function, first, it's rotational symmetric. If you make any rotation, the wave function doesn't change. So that means if we have anything like a s equal 2, there must be this contribution to the wave function. But if you write each one as a singlet, we have excluded that such a term appears. Now comes the nasty part. You have to show that the projection doesn't vanish. Now that I will skip, but I tell you, it doesn't vanish. And now we have constructed, okay, now one can work a little bit longer. So now we have constructed a ground state. One can show it's the only ground state which has this property. We know it's actually its energy, because each bond has the energy minus 2 over 3. Now the excitation gap is not so trivial to get out. But one can think a little bit with spin wave theory or play with it. It has an excitation gap. More interestingly, you very cheap get the edge states out. Because even here, I couldn't pair up this spin. So you see immediately, because in this wave function, I just paired up these spins. There's a remaining spin at the edge remain free. And it doesn't matter which direction it has. So on an open chain, I actually get four ground states. And the ground states are just determined what the edges are. Is this spin up, spin down? Is this spin up, spin down? If I make it on a torus, I have to pair up by periodic boundary condition these spins. And then I get the unique ground state. So you suddenly see this wave function really has this property that it is unique ground state in an infinite or on a torus. But as soon as it is an open system, it's fourfold degenerate, and the degeneracy is due to edge states. And the wave function doesn't break any symmetry. It doesn't have any order, spin order, long range order in a ground state. Good, and that's very remarkable, because now you see you have a wave function which is something people haven't seen before, this AKLT model. That's why it was so revolutionizing. Because typically, if you have spins, let's think, how can we make spins which don't have long range order? The only thing I can came up with is spins in magnetic field, all spins pointing along the magnetic field. That's a paramagnet. It doesn't have long range order because we don't have a symmetry. But this state is always unique. It has an excitation gap, but if we have finite boundary conditions, it still remains a unique state. If you think to cook up another wave function which doesn't have any long range order, it's ground state of a Hamiltonian, it's very hard to find something. That here we found something which is really a ground state of the Hamiltonian and doesn't break any order, any translational symmetry, no spin order. And it has this very remarkable property that at the edge it's fourfold degenerate. And that tells us there is something else which we miss so far in characterizing matter. And this is an example of a topological phase of matter. So, topological. Now, phase means, I know it's just a state, but with phase I mean that these properties which I tell you are robust if you change the parameter. So I wrote you now down an example of a state within its topological phase. If I change lambda, all these properties remain. Yes, the ground state degeneracy is no longer absolutely exact. It's just exponentially with system size. But it remains robust up to this exponentially small splitting. Yes, we can with lambda go to zero, and the Heisenberg spin one model is also in this phase. Now, to be more precise, does somebody know how to break the ground state degeneracy? Or how could you distinguish in which state you are if you apply a magnetic field, especially if you apply a local magnetic field? So local magnetic field breaks degeneracy. And therefore, we now know that this is a symmetry-protected topological phase. And I will tell you later the definition, especially tomorrow. So that's, it's an example of a symmetry protected topological phase. And symmetry protected means our Hamiltonian must respect the symmetry. We can add all terms to the Hamiltonian which respect the symmetry, which means which commute with the symmetry operation, and it will not split up. But there are certain terms which break the symmetry, and once we add them, they can split up the ground state degeneracy. There was a question, yes?
Does it extend to lambda zero?
Yes, it does. Yes, but I cannot do it analytically, you have to do it numerically, yes. It's actually a rather large area, surprisingly, so it's not fine-tuned at all. Good. So that tells us something very interesting happens, and this is Haldane phase or spin one half Haldane phase. It's also associated with Haldane gap. I will later tell you tomorrow that it's connected actually to the bosonic SSH chain Monica mentioned yesterday. And all these things are a little intertwined. And I hope I can explain you that in detail such that you understand it tomorrow. Yes?
Could you repeat one more time? What is the symmetry protecting here?
So symmetry protecting means you must require a symmetry of the Hamiltonian, which means here you can add SO3 rotation. Because we know our Hamiltonian, we can rotate our spin, it's spin 1, so we don't have SU2. We have SO3 rotation, and the Hamiltonian is SO3 invariant. So here, arbitrary rotation in space, actually. Let's just take the special one, which is sufficient. Which means if I rotate all spins, the Hamiltonian remains invariant. And you see this term doesn't break it, but a magnetic field breaks the rotation symmetry because it chooses a direction. So that tells us you can vary these hoppings arbitrarily. So you can make these hoppings random, small random variations to these hoppings. Add disorder to it. All these properties remain exactly. You don't have to be translationally invariant. You can make all these hoppings slightly I-dependent, and also make the lambda I-dependent, and add whatever term you have in mind which respects rotational symmetry. For example, add Si times Si plus 2 with a small prefactor. It will respect the symmetry, and you cannot destroy these properties. What has to happen is, if the perturbations get too large, the excitation gap will close, and then you will enter afterwards probably a new topological state. So that means as long as the excitation gap is present, all these properties are robust. And we can only enter a different phase by closing an excitation gap. Good. So that, yes?
So if we go 2D, everything breaks down, right?
Or with this wave function, yes. I don't know whether one can AKLT try to do in 2D, but I will immediately go to 2D and try to tell you, are similar states also in 2D possible? So, yes, so that's exactly the next step. Can we generate such state which has similar properties also in two dimensions? So what we want is an excitation gap, no long-range order, no spontaneous symmetry breaking, something special that the ground state degeneracy depends somehow how we arrange it. Yes. And the answer is, I will first tell you a little bit historically what is a this leads to resonating valence bond states. That was the historical approach to achieve it. But then I will take you the modern view, which is introduction to the toric code, which is exactly such a state, which is now called Z2 spin liquid, names not so important, where we can in 2D again construct an exact wave function with very related properties, and we can analyze what it is, what it behaves, and tell you that yes, there are states of matter which are completely different than spontaneous symmetry breaking and what we are used to in normal life. So that So historically, what did people try to do? We already told you that there is this state where we just have singlets. So let's go back to the Haarbach model, so the Heisenberg model. We know if you're on a square lattice, we have anti-ferromagnetic order. Let's frustrate the system. Let's put it on a triangular lattice. Because on a triangular lattice, I don't know how to make anti-ferromagnetic order. So let's shortly see. So let's again start with the Heisenberg model. H sum nearest neighbor Si Sj with a coupling strength J. But now we put it onto different lattices. And we want to introduce what is called frustration. Now, why is a triangular lattice frustrated? So if I choose this to be spin up, then the nail order tells me this is spin down. But I already know I can no longer satisfy this condition. So this state doesn't know, do I now have to be up and down? Does somebody know which one considers as even more frustrated lattices? No, hexagonal is not frustrated because it has AB lattice sites, like we heard. So hexagonal is like this. Oops. And you heard from Monica, it has nicely AB lattice sites. So we can perfectly order it. Yes, Kagome, exactly. So these are these special lattices. One probably has never heard about it if one works not in strongly correlated spin physics. And one knows how good people, how often people are if they can draw a Kagome lattice. Now let's try it. So, and this goes here, here we go here. Yeah, okay. Hope you can imagine somehow. And so now, so it's essentially, it's a honeycomb site lattice, but then you have always this triangle attached to it. So it's again a honeycomb, there are two triangles, here are two triangles, here are two triangles, here's a honeycomb again. And that makes a honeycomb lattice. And again, I don't know how to order on these lattice sites. And therefore the idea was now, once we punished the nail state, let's hope Heisenberg model on these lattices gives something interesting, doesn't order. And the idea was also motivated, which I introduced previously. So let's now make singlet pairs out of each bond and color it. So now I draw it in square lattice because that's simpler. So let's go back to our singlets, which we just allow, write down all states with a certain singlet configuration, which is allowed. But there are many of these states, because I'm allowed to draw all the singlet how I want. It's also not an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, because if I apply the Heisenberg interaction here, something strange happens. These two spins, these two singlets will flip. So if you apply the Heisenberg interaction onto this bond, you end up with the state where your singlets look like this. And that tells you somehow there's this huge amount of singlets, of dimer coverings which we have in the system. And what the Hamiltonian does is transform dimer coverings into other dimer coverings. So let's be very brave and write down a wave function which is just the equal weight superposition of all dimer coverings. So, ansatz psi is the sum over all dimer coverings. And here we have a dimer covering. And then people played a lot around with these states, and this is a so-called resonating valence bond state. So resonating valence bond state. Or in short, always RVB. And you may have heard that RVB is also considered to be important for high TC superconductors. And yeah. But not proven yet, just as a good variational wave function. Now, why don't we just do quantum Monte Carlo on these systems and get the answer for the Heisenberg model and the square lattice? I said you, everybody calculated it in the 80s. Why did nobody immediately do that with quantum Monte Carlo? Yes. So quantum Monte Carlo has sign problems, not only for fermions, but also for frustrated systems. So once you have frustration in your system, quantum Monte Carlo does also not work anymore. So these problems are hard to understand with modern numerical techniques. Yes?
Why is that?
Now you're asking a non-expert in quantum Monte Carlo about its problem. I once understood it. I have to shortly think and can explain it to you afterwards. Okay, yeah, maybe we shouldn't call it sign problem, but it's just there are too many landscapes to explore. So normally, if you don't have frustrations, you can with quantum Monte Carlo, you have to very quickly explore all the phase space. And with frustrations, you get stuck in certain phase space areas. And you cannot explore the full phase space. And you have to do extremely many samplings in order to get the correct phase space sampling. That's heuristic. Yes. Good, nowadays, but I think the conclusion is, let me just summarize, on a triangular lattice, there is spontaneous symmetry breaking. And it's a so-called 120 degree phase. That's these spins like to point somewhere in this direction, this points in this, this points in this. And then you can see that somehow you can cover the triangular lattice with such a spin configuration. And that's the 128 degree phase, which is also the classical ground state for Heisenberg model on the triangular lattice. Kaugummi lattice is, to my latest knowledge, a very, very strong candidate to be a spin liquid for the Heisenberg model. And just recently, starting this month, there was a model, now I have to go, which is even on the more complicated lattice, on the Ruby lattice, which are the lattice sites on the links of the Kaugummi lattice, which then mapped to a, so but this is with realistic Rydberg atoms, which then mapped to a dimer model, which had some special properties, and there were extremely strong numerical evidence that such a state appears, a spin liquid, featureless ground state, with some extremely nice properties. But before telling you this, so this problem, this I will tell you if you have another lecture time. Now, I will just tell you, how can we get something nice in two dimensions, again with a very nice toy model. And this toy model has extremely important applications for quantum computation as error correction code. So, and therefore also the name of the model comes not from condensed matter, but rather from quantum information theory, because it was invented as a code to protect quantum memory. And because it's but it's their topological properties which in the end protect the quantum memory, and then the condensed matter people immediately picked it up and noticed it's a spin liquid phase, what they were looking for all the time. Good. So that is very short over resonating valence bond. Now let's jump into another very beautiful model, easy to understand and very beautiful, which is the toric code. And just the name should tell you that it's something from a completely different field, because nobody knows probably what people understand under a code. So code, the word code comes from classical informatics and are ways to do error correction on classical bits. And so a code is something, some way where with redundancy you encode into a large number of physical bits, a certain amount of protected bits. That's where the word code comes from, and toric, because it was considered on the torus. And it was invented by Alexei Kitaev. And if you ever looked for papers by Alexei Kitaev, you most probably that he hasn't published it, but just put it on the archive. So I don't know whether the paper's ever published or it's still just lying on the archive since 20 years. Good, so what we start with is, I have to tell you the lattice. We start with a square lattice, but we do a little bit something special. We place our spins onto the links. Now that's still a square lattice, but the structure will be a little bit important of the underlying lattice. That's why it's very convenient to draw it like this. And then we write our Hamiltonian. So we just write some coupling strength minus. Yeah. I set my energy scale to 1, such I don't have to write it every time. So I just write minus sum over all lattice sides. So S, all lattice, now I screwed up with the color, so I have to use green. So these are lattice sides, sides S, and a side S has four spins attached to it. And so we sum over all lattice sides S, and there is an operator which is written AS, and the operator AS is the product of the four Pauli sigma z matrices for these four spins. So it's sigma z1, sigma z2, sigma z3, sigma z4. And if we would label it, it's 1, 2, 3, 4. And because writing sigma z is a nightmare, I use the shortcut introduction. I just write z, z, z. And z are the Pauli matrices. And you drop the indices because you know it's a product of the four Pauli z matrices which are attached, connected to the site S. And then we have a placket, which is this area. And it has also attached four spins. And therefore, we write a second term into our Hamiltonian, minus sum over all plackets, BP. And my operator BP is just the product of the four Pauli X operators. So that's X, 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 X. Now you know why it's not a Hamiltonian you would naturally write down for any system which you encounter in your lab. So it's really a mathematical, very mathematical constructed Hamiltonian. But it has extremely beautiful properties. So first is to notice that all these operators commute with each other. So all operators AS, BP, commute. Now that's trivial for AS at different sites. That's trivial for B operators at different sites. So why does this AS and this BP operator commute? Because they have different Pauli matrices inside. The answer is Pauli matrices anti-commute, but we always have two Pauli matrices in common. We have two spins in common. So when we commute them, there are two Pauli matrices to commute. Each one picks up a minus sign, so in that sense, the minus sign cancels and it's one. So if you make commutator of our AS with BP for BP here and AS here, these spins don't participate, that's no problem, we can commute them. They have the Pauli matrix here and the Pauli matrix here. But because they are, we can both commute them and pick up a minus, so we anti-commute them, pick up a minus sign, but because there are two, it cancels. So in other words, this is side 1 and 4, so this is equal to commutator of Z1 with Z4 with X1 and X4, but that is equal Z1, Z4 times X1, X4 minus X1, X4, Z1, Z4. So these two I can commute because these are different spins. So that's 1, 4. Oh, I have to change it. So that's X1, Z4. These two, when I commute them, I pick up a minus sign. So I get X4, Z4, minus. These two, I can commute and I pick up a minus sign. So that's X1, Z4, minus 1 squared. These two I can commute because they are different spins, and therefore it cancels. So indeed, we have a strange Hamiltonian, which is a sum of operators, but all operators commute with each other. So we know that the ground state, or all eigenstates, can be diagonalized with all these different operators. And especially we know that the ground state is the state which has eigenvalue 1 to all of these operators. So that tells us ground state. Psi satisfies Psi AS is equal Psi, and BP Psi is also equal Psi. Yes?
Sorry, maybe I missed what you
said,
but what is Z and X?
So, yeah. No, sorry, because I'm so familiar with the notation that it's hard to remember that. So, Z, I'm lazy, is Pauli matrix sigma Z. And I have here an index, so it's the Pauli matrix sigma Z of the fourth site. And X is the Pauli matrix X, the X Pauli matrix. So this here is sigma X at some site. Yes? So what are the eigenstates of the Pauli matrices? 1 and minus 1. So, and the product of 4 Pauli matrices, so it can only be 1 and minus 1. So 1, and because I choose here minus sign, it must be 1. So that is the lowest state. Yeah, no, sorry, I should have explained to you that, yes, these operators have only two eigenvalues, 1 and minus 1. Good. Now let us think a little bit of the RVB state. Let us draw the condition that on a square lattice that we are an eigenstate of all sigma Z operators. So let us think of a state which has eigenvalue AS equal 1 on all our sites. Now we can draw such a state. So I again use spin up, spin down, red and blue. So if this one is spin up and these two spin down, then we know that, yes, we get 2 minus signs here, 1 plus sign, so that one has to be spin up. Now let's assume this one is also spin up, this is also spin up, then this one has also to be spin up. Then if you can go here, so let's this spin up, this spin down. If this is spin down, that one also has to be spin down if you want to get eigenvalue 1. So let's shortcut it a little bit. Let's draw a line whenever the spin is spin up and nothing if the spin is down. So then you get something like this. Oh, yeah, that's not allowed. And I screwed up somewhere. And that is not allowed. So that must be no spin. Yes, now it looks fine. So in total, what it tells you, So that one is also forbidden, you're telling me?
Left.
No, that's no problem. That is allowed. Again? No, the plaquette is sigma x. These are. I will tell you immediately what sigma x is doing. Just look at the AS. Yes. So what I tell you is, each configuration which satisfies this condition is a loop. I can draw loops on my square lattice. The only condition is the loops are not allowed to end. I must have all at each vertex, I must have an even number of loops entering and leaving. There can be four loops, there can be two loops, or two lines coming in, four lines, or zero lines. Forbidden is one or three lines. So that means that all states which satisfy this are eigenstates of this operator, I can graphically represent as all possible ways how I draw loops onto my square lattice. What does this operator do? It flips the spin. So let's apply a BS onto this plaquette. It flips this spin, but also these two spins. So it makes this. So it makes one loop configuration into the next one. So that tells us that, so one operator, now we're back with our RVB states, where we had the dimer coverings. Very similar. We have a state, a set of states, which we can characterize by lines. And then we have a second term in a Hamiltonian, which makes equal weight superposition of these states. And now you'll see immediately what is the ground state. The ground state is the equal weight superposition of all my loop configurations. And that is the ground state of this Hamiltonian. So let us write this down. Ground state is the equal weight superposition of all loop coverings. That means psi is the sum over all our loops of the states which have a loop covering and some normalization. That is the equal weight superposition. Now we can start to analyze, is this state unique? Let's count. So, how many operators A, S, B, S do we have? Now it depends a little bit on the geometry. Let's first think infinite sphere, infinite plane. Yeah, I'm cheating, let's go onto the sphere. Let's somehow put everything, I don't know how, yeah, it's a little bit tough to put the square lattice onto the sphere, but let's try to do it somehow. Let's distort it. And important point is, sphere is a little bit complicated. Let's make just infinite plane and count. So then for every lattice site, we have one AS operator. For every plaquette, we have also a BP operator. And we actually have two N spins. So there are two N spins. And there are 2n spins, so the Hilbert space is 2 in power of 2n. There are n AS operator and n BP operator. So that means, but if you think of it, you have equal degree of freedom as you have operators, constraints on the system. If all these operators are independent, this is the unique ground state. When are they not independent? If you make periodic boundary conditions, or if you put it onto a torus. But on a torus, so now I draw a torus with periodic boundary conditions, think we now have periodic boundary conditions, and look what is the product of all AS operator. So we have one, maybe I should have made a small torus, just one like this. So this side is equal to this side on a torus. So we have one here, but that one link is again this link. So, and this one is equal to this one, so A, maybe it's a little too much. So this AS involves this, 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 and this side. This AS operator involves this, 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 and this. This AS operator involves this, this, this. And which one did I miss? And this one involves this, 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 and this. So every side appears twice. So that means this is identity. And the same for the VP operator. So that means there are two of these operators, so there are two missing degrees of freedom. So that means two spins are not fixed by making equal weight of loop configurations. And I can immediately tell you which ones. Because let's think you have such a loop on a torus. I can do whatever that I want. I cannot remove this loop by BS operators. So in that sense, no loop, if I start with the state no loop and apply BS operators, I can get the class of dimer covering, of loop coverings. But I will never achieve this loop on a torus. And also never this loop. And therefore now you have the four ground states. You can either start with the state which doesn't have any loop. You can start with one loop which goes around this. Or you can add a loop which goes around this, or with both loops present. But because these loops cannot be contracted on a torus to zero, we cannot remove them. And now you see the beauty immediately. So that ground state degeneracy scales with the genus of your surface. If you add another loop, if you make a torus with another torus, you have additional loops which are non-contractible, and the number of ground states scales with this additional loop. And this is another example, very important property of a topological phase. The ground state degeneracy depends on the genus of the surface where it is defined. Or in other words, if you don't like the genus, if you make holes into our system, into your system, which can end or not, the ground state degeneracy depends on the number of holes which you have inside. So, let me state. What is the? Oh, I think I'm finished. Is that correct? Oh, no, I probably don't have another hour. Okay, so let's finalize this statement. So, on a torus, we have four ground states. And in general, ground state degeneracy scales with genus of surface. That's why I wanted to do it on a sphere, because they're at zero. Or if you don't like to make something on a torus, think adding holes in it. And that's why it has the name toricord. So let's, what other properties do we have? We know all eigenstates. So every eigenstate is a violation of one of these operators. So it's clear there is a gap. Because whenever we have a state where one operator is not satisfied, we have to pay the energy one. So it's a gapped state. We can do whatever we want. We cannot distinguish these states locally. We really have to see whether there's a loop going through the system. So locally, these states look completely equivalent. And we have to do something non-local to see that, to distinguish them. Good, I think with that, it's a good point to stop here. Now I'm not so far as I hoped to, but yes. Important is, I think I will finish toricord tomorrow, so it's, I hope it's fine if I focus on explaining you toricord in more detail and give you a summary than doing and then explaining you the physics which we did in the lab. So I think you have enough heard results of latest physics. Let's, I hope it's fine if I focus explaining you how these things work. Good, then I wish you a nice evening. Questions, but I think there. Yes?
You might have said this and I might have missed it, but I can imagine having two windings around the torus. And is it just that that is contractible to zero windings?
Yes, two windings. Things they are just next to each other. You apply a string of VPS around and it just gets annihilated. Yeah, so yes, and the torus, two windings on the torus are equivalent to no winding.